about this album is a secret.
What's up, everybody? Once again, it's BrandMan Sean, and today we got to go over the secret evolution of Taylor Swift and her genius rebranding. Shout out to Cole Schieffer requesting that I do a video on Taylor Swift's strategy, and even you, Mega YouTube, because I did a video last December 2016, talking about how you can create complete image freedom, and in that I mentioned because of the perfect goody-goody image that Taylor Swift has, it's hard for her to be a bad girl, but because of recent things that have happened, Mega YouTube said, hey, you were wrong. Taylor Swift is now bad. Not exactly, but it is a fact that she pushed her brand to a farther edge than she ever has before, while at the same time reinvigorating her fan base. And that's a huge accomplishment for somebody who's already accomplished so much and being this late in her career. But how was she able to do this? Magic. Now, what I mean by that is the little magic trick she played for her big first move in terms of her reputation rollout. What she did was, back in August, she deleted every single post on her Instagram page, got everybody's attention. And just like a magician, there's no point of performing the trick if nobody's watching. So what Taylor Swift did is, hey everybody, I'm here. And she got people talking, blogs everywhere, fans, but even greater than that, magicians want your focused attention, because when you're trying to figure out how a magician did a trick, you're focusing and you're following every single motion that they're going through, but they practice each of these strategic movements. So now you're being guided, thinking you're figuring it out, but you're going on the journey that they actually want you to go, which amplifies when the result actually happens. You watch closely and then bam, they hit you with the result. So in this same vein, when she deleted every single post on her Instagram, it was now blank space. And one post in blank space is more powerful than a post in a lot of spaces. So now people are really focused and following, what is Taylor trying to say? What is she trying to do? They're closely watching every single movement at this point. And on top of that, they were able to build up to the big moment where they really dropped the bomb with the "Look What You Made Me Do" video. She went very direct and confrontational in how she attacked and came at people in this video. I'm not gonna go into all of the signs and messages in the video. I'll put a link in description below to somebody else's video. There's been a lot of great breakdown of those. But one of the big references was to the ongoing relationship with Kanye West. And here in the video, she basically says, hey, I don't like you. You and you're on your tilted stage. Everybody knows that Kanye West did the floating stage. She even goes as far as ripping off the font for Kanye West's Life of Pablo project and using that as the reputation font for her new project and the tour merch and everything. And when you look at the darker images in this video, this is kind of what Mega YouTube 99 was probably referring to when saying that Taylor went bad. As a matter of fact, there was even a Forbes writer that basically said that for the first time, Taylor Swift is the villain. Neither one of those are correct though. Taylor Swift would never want to actually be a real villain. That's just not the image and how she's building her career out. So the question is, how was someone with a traditionally clean image like Taylor able to go so dark and do certain things without it traditionally hurting her brand? One simple thing: the power of context. In this video, Taylor has a clip where she lets you know the old Taylor is dead.
I'm sorry, the old Taylor can't come to the phone right now. Why? She's dead.
What's so important about that part of the video is she's prepping the minds of the audience. She's letting them know that you're about to experience a side of Taylor that you haven't experienced before. Once she has that disclaimer working for her, she lessens the blow a little bit. But even greater than that, she also has multiple characters of Taylor within the video. So the more evil, conniving player that she might be playing is also offset by these other versions of Taylor Swift that are a lot more nostalgic for a lot of Taylor Swift fans, because they get to re-experience all these versions and periods of Taylor Swift that also, of course, resonates with specific periods of their lives. But on top of that, you also have to look at the fact that since there's multiple characters of Taylor in this video, the villain version of Taylor is presented as, at most, a side of Taylor. And at least a lot of people will probably just look at it as Taylor Swift playing dress up. She's putting on another character amongst these other characters. And Taylor Swift is pretty cognizant of that, because if you look at videos where she presents that more evil, conniving version of herself, there's usually offset by at least that good version of herself. If you look at her other video, I'll play right here. I can't remember the name of it. As opposed to just saying, this is who I am. She's usually playing this character instead, which is also why when she's playing the more edgy character of herself, she has to hint to the audience by using dark visuals because nobody thinks of Taylor that way naturally. As a matter of fact, the same Forbes writer who said that Taylor was playing the villain later said in the same article these words. The key for brands, and this might sound crazy, is that you don't always have to be the goody two shoes. There are times when you could push the boundary of what people think of your brand, provided they are in on the joke. And they'll like you even more when you make the turn back to the good guy. Just about everybody is in on the joke. People are not really seeing Taylor Swift as the villain. Once again, she would never even want to be seen legitimately as a villain. And that's all because of the context created, though, that she was able to do the things that she did brilliantly without being positioned as a true, I'm coming out as some kind of bad guy and I'm just doing something that's completely out of character and confusing for an audience. As a matter of fact, if you still don't believe it, you can even cue to the end of the video where she's self-deprecating about the whole narrative of her always playing the victim.
Y'all, oh, stop acting like you're all nice. You are so fake. Oh, there she goes, playing the victim again.
She's saying that, but at the very same time, consider the title of the song, Look What You Made Me Do. These bad things that she's doing in this video, the shady things that she's saying and images that she's showing, this isn't Taylor being Taylor. She's not a bad person by nature. You are making her do these bad things. So in a sense, she's still kind of a victim in that way. The power of context. The context was really the foundation to allow Taylor Swift to have more wiggle room to be a little bit more edgier and do certain things without being confusing to her audience. Taylor Swift really moves a lot more like Beyonce than a Rihanna or a Miley Cyrus, who might, you know, go some of those more extreme routes. They slowly peel back layer by layer over time, so they just slowly need to give themselves more wiggle room as opposed to just all at once saying, hey, I want to be able to do this, so I'm going to do something really crazy and hopefully these people will rock with me. And these are all very powerful strategies and tactics that any type of brand can use. So once again, Taylor Swift, she got everybody's attention, and especially using the blank canvas, she created a mystery and got people to pay close attention to the rebranding process with her secret approach of releasing things. But on top of that, while she was doing that and having them pay close attention, she was able to evolve and rebrand right in front of people's face by consistently creating context for the new direction that she wanted to go, as opposed to saying, hey, I'm this now, I was here, but I'm this now. She just created context and went there, and everybody understood innately by all of the cues that were given on the way. And that's the power of context when you're rebranding. That's about it. So if you like this video, go ahead and hit that like button. And if you like it, you might as well share it. And if you're not subscribed, you know what to do. Hit that subscribe button.